Good morning and welcome to our online service, the Vernon Church of Christ, this Sunday morning. Thank you for being with us today. Hope you've had a good week. Hope you had a Merry Christmas and looking forward to the new year that's soon to be with us. Be sure to go ahead and get your Bibles out and have them ready as we go into our worship this morning. Follow along and take notes. Whatever you need to do, help us to better understand God's Word. Again, thank you for being with us. This time, let us begin with a word of prayer. Well, thank you, Lord, for this day of life. Well, thank you for the blessings of this year. Even though it's been difficult in many ways, you have blessed us in more ways we ever realized. Be with us in the new coming year. Help us always appreciate what you do for us. Be with our sick, watch over them, and help us until the end. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and so shall I be saved from my enemies. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and so shall I be saved from my enemies. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord.
Throughout the years, we've done a pretty good job when it comes to teaching about Christ, talking about all the prophecies that he fulfilled and coming to this world, talking about his virgin birth, talking about his many teachings that he gave to the people, the many miracles, his death, his burial, his resurrection, talking about his plan of salvation that he provided for all mankind. We've done a pretty good job with that. But one thing maybe we have not done such a great job on is talking about what Jesus is doing right now. What is Jesus doing right now? When I mean right now, I mean right now as we speak. What is Christ doing? You ever given that much thought? Have we ever talked a whole lot about that when it comes to our lessons, our preaching, our Bible study, about what Jesus is doing right now? Well, he's doing something. And there are many individuals who feel that maybe he's not doing anything. He accomplished everything that he did on this earth, and because of that, he's in heaven now, just maybe in the easy boy, sit back, legs kept up, just waiting for the time to come when he returns on the second coming. So what is Christ doing right now? Of course, we do know that he completed everything that God gave him to do. Here's what Christ said in John 17 and verse 4. I have glorified you on the earth. I have finished the work which you have given me to do. Another verse, John 19 and verse 30. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. So here we find two verses of many showing that Christ completed everything God gave him to do while he was on this earth. So now, what is he doing? Is he just kicked back, taking it easy? Well, no, not that at all. Christ is very, very busy. Busy doing what? Well, for one, he is preparing a place for us right now. As we speak right now, he is preparing for us a place. Well, how do we know this? Look what John chapter 14, 2 and 3 says. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Christ right now is preparing a great place for us. Now the thing about it, this is all we know about it. He didn't give us any hints. He didn't send us any plans, anything like that. What Christ has given to us is this promise. He is preparing for us a great place. It will be nothing like anything on this earth we've ever experienced. Things on this earth, they have a way of rotting. They have a way of being destroyed. But no, not in heaven. Of course, all these things we have here on earth one day will be destroyed. But in heaven, always will they be there. So what do we know Christ is doing right now? He is preparing a place for us in heaven. And that should give us comfort. So he's busy doing it. We know that one thing. A second thing we know that Christ is doing, he is standing at the right hand of God. How do we know that? Well, whenever Stephen was being stoned, it was there that he looked, gazes up into heaven, and what does he see? He sees Christ. We read of this in Acts chapter 7, 55 and 56. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and said, "Look, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." So one of the last things that Stephen sees before they begin stoning him to death, he looks up into heaven and there he sees Christ. Oh, what a sight to behold. And he's at the right hand of God. Think of the comfort that that gave to Stephen, knowing that he was soon to be with his Lord, soon to be with him after standing for truth, and now they're putting him through this. Again, that had to be a great comfort. Another verse that we have that helps to complement what Stephen saw is in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. Here the writer says, "Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high." Here this verse speaks of the brightness of his glory. As Christ is there, as Stephen gazes up to Christ, it's just a brightness that illuminates around him. Again, the things that Stephen saw that day had to be great, had to be comforting to him because of what he is about to go through. It speaks of his majesty on high. Again, if we could only see that, I'm sure it would have given us comfort as well. So one thing that we know for certain that Christ is doing right now, he's at the right hand of God. Another thing the scriptures tell us that Christ is doing right now, he's making intercession. He's going to God on our behalf. Take a court of law, for example. You have the prosecution, and then you have you to defend it there. And beside you, you have a lawyer, an attorney. And that attorney is there pleading your case, trying to show that you are innocent. Well, that's what Christ is doing for us right now. He's pleading our case before God, showing our innocence. Look what he says in Romans 8, 33 and 34. "Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God and also makes intercession for us." Here we find Christ making intercession for us. If you notice there in verse 33, God who justifies, that means we have been acquitted. God looks at us. Christ is speaking to God on our behalf. And Christ says, "Look, there's nothing here to condemn them with. There are no sins. They are faithful to me. They are our children. Their sins have been washed away by my blood." And God looks and there's nothing there. Nothing there to condemn us with. So Christ is our intercessor, is what he is. And as long as we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have that forgiveness every day. And when God looks, there's nothing there. And Christ says, "You see, he's covered by my blood." We're told that in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 7, you see. So according to what we see here, how great it is that we have Christ interceding on our behalf. Another verse we see is in 1 John 2 and verse 1. Here it says, "My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous." So we have an advocate. We have an intercessor. That's what we have. Going to God on our behalf. Well, you might say, "Well, why do I need this?" Well, ask yourself this. Have you sinned today? Have you sinned in any way by doing that which is wrong, or maybe not doing everything that is right? Well, we probably have. And the thing about it, when we commit these sins, Christ, he goes to God on our behalf. Because we're walking in the light, we're faithful. He says, Lord, it's been forgiven. They're covered by the blood, my blood, he says. So therefore, we have that advocate. We have that intercessor. Christ is busy. He is busy in heaven going to God on our behalf. And that we should be thankful. We certainly don't want to go before God without an intercessor, without this advocate. Because if we go before God standing on our own, it's not going to end very well for us. It's going to be a tragic ending, and we'll find ourselves all eternity in a devil's hell. We've got to have him as an intercessor, and he is there for his children. Another thing we find Christ doing in heaven, he is observing. He's looking down. In Hebrews 4, 12 and 13, here's what it says. For the word of God is a living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, of the joints and marrow. It is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Christ is observing. If you notice there in verse 12, a discerner of our thoughts and our intents. He knows our heart. He knows our intentions. He knows everything about us. And he's looking down and he sees these things. He knows what's going on. Again, we need to think about that. Before we do things that we know that are wrong, Christ knows our thoughts. He knows our heart. He knows our intentions. He knows everything about us. So he's looking down from us, observing what is taking place, just like he did those of Revelation. You know, when it comes to that day when we, before God in judgment, there are going to be books that are going to be opened. And look what is said in Revelation 20 and verse 12. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. We're told here about some books that are going to be opened on the day of judgment. We know of three. One is going to be the Bible itself. We're going to be judged on how we kept the Word of God. We all have a copy of it. We need to read it, know it, understand it, and do our very best to live by it. We're going to be judged by that book. There's going to be another book that's going to be opened, the Lamb's Book of Life. And in that book, we'll find our name, hopefully, if we are faithful children of God, have done as God said to become that Christian, he puts our names in that book. A great place for our name to be. And then we have what some call the book of deeds. All the deeds that we have done on this earth are recorded, both good and bad. And on that day when the books are open, if we are faithful children of God, the bad things that we have done will not be there. Remember, they've been forgiven, erased, eradicated. They're not there. And when it's presented before God, he looks and our intercessor says, there's nothing here to condemn with. It's all good. So there's a book of deeds. We see that here in Revelation 12 and verse 20 about the books. But also look what 2 Corinthians 5:10 says. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. So here, a book of deeds again, recorded in the books the things we have done, good or bad, when we stand before God. And how great it's going to be that when we do stand before God as faithful Christians, nothing bad is going to be there. Again, it's been erased. It's been covered by the blood of Christ. And that's what we want. How wonderful it is. Remember those seven churches in Revelation chapters 2 and 3? It was there that Christ said to them, I know your works. He knows our works as well. He knows what we are doing. And he also knows that we're going to reap what we sow. Look what he says in Galatians 6, 7 and 8. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. And he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Jesus knows what we're sowing. I think we do as well. If we're sowing to the flesh, then we're going to reap corruption. If we're sowing to the Spirit, then we're going to have everlasting life. But let's not be deceiving ourselves or anyone else. God certainly is not deceived. You can't go out here and sow to the flesh and think, well, I'm going to reap everlasting life from it. Oh, that's not going to work. We simply reap what we sow. So Christ knows this. He knows what we're sowing, and He knows one day what we're going to reap as well. So we need to ask ourselves, what is Christ doing right now? As we have seen, he's doing many things right now. Many things. He's not just sitting around waiting for the time, watching the clock, waiting for the time to return. Not Christ. He is busy. Busy on our behalf, doing so much for us, preparing the great place of heaven that will be our home one day. The question for each of us is, will heaven be my home? Will it? Well, if you're not a faithful child of God, it won't be. You need to be faithful. Be faithful unto death, as Revelation 2:10 tells us. And we know that all these things will come about because God keeps His word. If you're not a faithful child of God, why not give us a call? We need to talk about that. Put you back on the right trail, right path, walking in that light where your sins are forgiven as you commit them every day. Again, think about that. If you're not a child of God, you need to become that child and let God put your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Write your name in heaven. He wants to do that. I know you believe. Why not do as the Bible says, repent of your sins, as Luke 13:3 tells us. Why not confess the great name of Christ, as Romans 10:9-10, and be baptized into Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, Acts 2:38, and then begin living a faithful life before Him, Revelation 2:10. That's what it takes. That's the plan of salvation. God has laid it out for us so plain. Do we want to be His children? To know that one day heaven will be our home. Christ is busy. He's busy. He's looking. He's waiting. Waiting for you to make that move if you're not right in either way. He wants you to be a part of His life, a part of His home one day there in heaven. Ask ourselves, are we ready? If there's any way that we can help you, you'll see the phone number there at the bottom of the screen, and give us a call. We'll get back with you as soon as possible and talk to you about this all-important subject, that is your salvation. At this time, let us close in a word of prayer. Well, thank you, Lord, for all you do for us, and we thank you, Lord, that you're looking out for us right now. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for the cleansing that we have every day of it. Help us always appreciate it. Be with our sick that are mentioned, Lord, and help them that are needing our prayers and having difficulties right now. Watch over them and be with them. Thank you so much for loving us and giving us another day. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught the Lord. Bring.
Preparation for the Lord's Supper, we'll be reading Luke chapter 22, 19 and 20. And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you." Let us pray for the bread. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son Jesus and giving of his body. May our minds go back to the cross, the suffering that he did there for us. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Again, let us bow as we give thanks for the fruit of the vine. Again, our Father, we thank you for Jesus' blood he shed on the cross for us. May our minds go back to the cross for every drop he shed. For it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. We're also commanded to give back on the first day of the week as we have prospered this week. Acts 20, verse 7 says, "Now on the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight." Let us give thanks. Well, thank you, Lord, for every blessing you send our way. And be with us, Lord, as we give back to your work of the church. We do so with a cheerful heart. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Vainly they watch his bed, Jesus, my Savior. Vainly they seal the dead, Jesus, my Lord. Death cannot keep his prey, Jesus, my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with the mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose,
he arose,
he arose,
he arose,
hallelujah. From the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign.
He arose,
he arose,
he arose,
he arose,
hallelujah.
Thanks for being with us again today. Hopefully something can be said today that's helped us to understand what Christ is doing right now. Again, thanks for being with us. If you can be with us at the church building this morning at 10:45, there we'll be in person. Also, just to let you know, we're not having an evening service at 5 for a while, nor a Wednesday evening service. We're sort of putting those off for a while till this virus sort of calms down, and maybe then we can come back together as soon as all this is hopefully taken care of real soon. Just want to let you know that. But we're thankful you have been with us this morning here by the internet, and hopefully again you'll be with us again next week. Hopefully at the church building, 9:30 or 10:45, or here by the web at 10 o'clock. Be sure to look at the end of our program for those who are sick. They certainly need our prayers. Look at those and go to God on their behalf and pray for them and those who are helping them in any way they can. Again, thank you for being with us. Look forward to our next time. Hope you have a great new year. Thank you, and may God bless.